Idiocracy, a movie made about a future in which humans had declined mentally through a lack of natural selection to the point of absurdity, is often referred to when viewing the current political and societal scape. It was first laughed at because it seemed ridiculous at the time of its release. But in recent years, this laughter has seemed to have turned to nervous laughter. The tone has changed. Modern-day humans have an average cranial capacity of 1,380 cc's, while our ancestors, the Cro-Magnons, had a whopping 1,660 cc's. The difference between those two is about the same difference between modern humans' cranial capacity and that of the late Homo erectus. Homo erectus, living 2 million years ago, being one of the most primitive human ancestors that we consider to be human. Cro-Magnons were around 10 centimeters taller and far more muscular, with a heavy, strong skeleton when compared to modern humans. What is going on, and how did we get here? When people first learn about the evolution of humanity and where we come from, a very curious and important question often arises. Are we still evolving today? And if so, how? And into what? In a simple answer, yes, we are, and not in the way we should be. You see, in order to understand where exactly our species is headed, we need to look backward into our past to understand what shaped us before we started wearing suits and taking medicine in a very safe living environment. Our time as cavemen makes up more than 99% of our history as humans. And this was truly the furnace that forged and shaped our species into what it is. We were designed to survive in a very unique and specific lifestyle that remained mostly the same for hundreds of thousands of years until now. We often like to focus on the physical side of our evolution, walking hundreds of kilometers in a month, hunting and eating large ferocious animals, and sometimes facing each other in combat. But a fundamental aspect of this is often forgotten: the mind we used to make life or death decisions. The biggest factor in survival, arguably, is our ability to choose an option that leads to safety and abundance while avoiding death and injury. Let's demonstrate this with a practical example. You are the leader of a family group following a herd of deer through a forest as they migrate. Winter is nearing, and there really isn't much else to eat in this pine forest. You come across a ravine with a fast-flowing river at its base. You look for a way across and are presented with a few options. A large tree has fallen across the ravine, and perhaps we could walk across it. Down below, there are a few rocks in the river, about jumping distance apart. We could make it that way. The ravine looks to be quite deep for a long way away, and it would most likely take half a day for us to find a simple, safe crossing. Opting to save time, you decide to lead your family across the fallen tree. After all, the deer are moving quickly through the forest, and we can't afford to lose them. Halfway across the tree, it cracks under the weight of our family, and everyone crashes 40 feet down into the rocky, turbulent river. The end. A simple decision like this meant the difference between your DNA surviving or being sent into the void, never to see the light of day again. Now, compound this situation again, hundreds of times a day, for each human being for hundreds of thousands of years. The amount of critical decisions made over the last 300,000 years is an astronomical number, difficult for our brains to even comprehend, and their effects are more than obvious, creating the smartest creature this planet has ever been home to. Most humans born on this planet never made it to sexual maturity. Most lives ended before they even had the chance to have children. And this fact is extremely important when understanding our evolution. Most genes were being removed constantly, only leaving the strongest and smartest who could make it to the age to successfully have children. The average life expectancy during the Paleolithic time was only around 33, and after which, during the Neolithic period, it dropped down to a staggering 20 years old. Currently, we are at the life expectancy of around 70 years old, meaning we have four times less genetic selection than just a few thousand years ago. Fast forward to the beginning of civilization, and now humans are in a much safer environment with more food security and many more people to aid with big tasks such as emergencies, knowledge of medicine, tools, and construction for shelter. We've just removed more than half of the things that can remove humans, and arguably even more. Bad decisions don't lead to death nearly as often, and the illogical survive. The physical requirements had been massively reduced too. No longer were you required to walk 20 kilometers a day as a nomadic hunter out in the elements in pursuit of prey. A broken leg? That's okay. You can stay in your hut and your family will bring you food. Sickly and with a bad immune system, we will give you a job you can do while sitting and will support you when you're in ill health. If you weren't strong enough, fast enough, or able to react in time, it didn't really matter as much anymore. You'd have children, and they would have more, in the absence of the great eliminator that is natural selection. This is the story of humanity and is essentially what makes us human. Compassion, family, mercy, kindness, and working together is what gave us success and created the society we live in and enjoy today. But at what cost? Thousands of years of DNA that would have been eliminated through the process of survival of the fittest was now allowed to survive and spread, becoming intertwined in every human alive. Illnesses that would most certainly have caused our ancestors not to reach successful mating age now did not cause this to happen anymore. Bad eyesight that would have made life in the harsh abysm of the food chain impossible no longer was eliminated. These humans survived, having children who inherited the same problems their forebearers endured. And if you think you skipped all of these and are the one lucky one who is in perfect health, the product of a line of humans unaffected by these maladies, I'd like to ask you how many ancestors you have. Our brains work in a linear fashion, and we like to see things in straight lines, but this is not how evolution works. You have two parents, four grandparents, eight grandparents, and so on. That seems all pretty understandable, but let's go further. Let's go back just to the Middle Ages, roughly 1,000 years ago. You have over a billion ancestors from the Middle Ages. This is a staggering number, and may not be something you'd be able to wrap your head around at just this point. But it took all these millions and millions of humans alive, not too long ago, to create you here today. Unfortunately, it would be impossible for millions and billions of humans to avoid these faulty genes along the way. And here we are today, the product of this astronomical number of humans. Let's fast forward again to the modern day. Let's inject into the equation things like advanced medicine, clean, safe living conditions, and a notable lack of wars, violence, and conflict. What a blessing to be alive in such a time. But we have unwittingly created the perfect conditions for disaster. Humans are now facing their next greatest challenge for survival, and seemingly no one is talking about it or even addressing it as a problem. We have almost completely removed the primary mechanism that kept humans safe from genetic catastrophe. We have essentially become a batch of seedlings raised in a glass dome, away from the wind, cold, and blistering sunlight, becoming ever more weak and unable to grow strong, resilient structures, able to weather storms and survive the elements. Diseases that would have eliminated us at birth no longer do. A careless, illogical decision no longer removes us from the genetic pool, and we are no longer tested in combat against wild creatures or human enemies in battle. The feeble survive and procreate, and this is through no fault of our own. We are bound to our humanity and our compassion. Empathy restricts us from allowing nature to take its course. And before anyone jumps to conclusions, I speak as one of these very humans who would have been eliminated very early on, as I was saved by doctors as a baby. I would have been just another statistic that did not make it to adulthood, as I was almost taken by encephalitis at a ripe old age of a few months old. Am I thankful for being saved by our modern circumstances? Yes, I am. Am I deeply worried for the future of our species? Absolutely. Over the past few decades, scientists have been aware of something deeply troubling. IQ scores are declining. The average intelligence of Western countries have been falling since around the Victorian era, and now have declined around a total of 14 IQ points. This number may not sound very large, but it is astronomical. The difference between an IQ of 79 and that of 93 is the difference between being borderline mentally handicapped and the latter being a functional member of society with a more or less average IQ. I use Western countries as a primary example because IQ has been increasing in most other parts of the world, which can muddy the waters. The primary mechanism behind this is the increase in nutrition, and particularly protein, which seems to have a massive effect on the IQ of developing children. Western countries have had a more stable nutritional profile, and yet here we see this steady decline of IQ. In recent times, there has been a giant pushback by the general community as to the validity of IQ, and several have tried to prove it to be an inadequate measure of intelligence. This, however, is purely subjective, and IQ still stands as a very central pillar in psychology, and is even used by the United States military in recruitment, as its effects have been seen to be so influential that a person below the IQ of around 83 is quote-unquote untrainable. Something that is found to be a standard of psychology as a whole, and is used functionally by the most advanced military force in the world, is not something to be discounted easily. This decline in IQ is a result of the lack of evolutionary pressure eliminating those not smart enough to survive. It just doesn't exist anymore. And seemingly from fertility rates, it seems that those with lower IQs tend to have more children earlier on in life. At current rates, the effects we could see in just a handful of generations is astounding. We are already in this process and are in fact a product of this unfortunate phenomenon. Its effects have been so significant that if we had to go back to 30,000 BC, capture a Cro-Magnon, bring him back to the present day and educate him, he would most likely be one of the smartest people on the planet. Having a brain 20% bigger than ours and ultimately just being better than modern humans, physically, mentally, and possibly even emotionally. A common counter-argument in this conversation is that brain size doesn't equate intelligence. And largely, this is just cope. Excuses to make ourselves feel better by trying to explain how perhaps we have more efficient brains or that we have more folds in our brain is all just denial of obvious facts that make us feel highly uncomfortable about our own evolutionary decline. Prehistoric humans were better in basically every measurable way. So where do we go from here? Are we doomed to a genetic apocalypse? One where our great-grandchildren will live in a world full of sickness, weakness, and a lack of adequate intelligence to keep our civilizations afloat? It doesn't have to be if we do something about it. The next step in human evolution will, and kind of has to be, genetically engineering our children. We now have, for the first time in Earth's history, the ability to directly influence our own evolutionary path. And what a blessing this is to have. The idea of tampering with our children's DNA is still incredibly fringe, but really is one of the most plausible and effective ways for us to prevent the inevitable decline we have seen and will see so much more of in the future. There are already options for genetic editing in a few select countries as it stands today. However, the industry of designer babies is largely illegal in most of the world. An interesting choice, seeing as though it would dramatically improve the IQ, health, and strength of their own citizens. What we may see in the future is a country or a group of countries that allow genetic editing and largely overtake others as they outcompete them completely, leaving them in the dust. Other countries will most likely follow in their steps and adopt the same protocols, as we have already seen with other societal changes that shift across the world. We may see a future of people far smarter than we are today, free of ill health and strong enough to live a good, fruitful life. But first, we as a society will need to overcome our ideas of ethics surrounding this new frontier and make a step in the best direction we as a species will ever make for our survival of the human race. Something will need to be done, and this is our best bet by far.